And Grace teaches a subject called gender studies, but that's in the Department of Community Development. So that's why she wants to talk with women here, because they're bringing the role of women up. Well, it's a different culture. And now women are getting jobs, and they're working in factories, they're working in shops, they own their own stores. They're really changing dramatically. Men still expect women to stay home, cook the meals, take care of the kids, fetch the water, and do everything. And then now women want to go to work, so you can imagine what that does to a culture. If anybody has questions for Grace before her presentation, she can do that.
No. Let's see. Yes. How long was your flight to get here?
It took almost 34 hours.
Oh, wow.
Oh. But I was breaking to almost two airports.
Okay.
From Tanzania to Zurich, Switzerland, mm-hmm. and then to Neuer,
right.
and then Portland. All together, 34 hours.
Wow.
Yes.
And then due to the weather, she had to fly from Portland over here. Because it was really snowing the day I was supposed to go to pick her up. A couple feet up at the mountains, so not that good.
Yes, please.
Will you be showing us a map of Africa?
Oh.
Not maybe next
Sunday, I can prepare the map.
I'm just trying to picture where.
Oh,
where you're
Tanzania.
From?
Tanzania. Yeah, we are on the east south of African continent,
okay.
near Indian Ocean.
Okay,
we're just close to the Indian Ocean. Actually, a large part of the Indian Ocean can be seen while in Tanzania. Yeah. Yes.
Where is Dar es Salaam in Tanzania? Are you near Kilimanjaro or some distance?
We are on the coastal.
You're on the coastal. Okay.
Yes.
And there.
Kilimanjaro is on the northern part, but I'm originally from the northern part.
Okay.
Yes. But living in the rest now. Yes.
Dar es Salaam is a city of about 4 million people.
Yeah.
Go ahead. People will be coming, but that's okay.
Yeah.
All right. There you go.
As it is shown on the presentation, those are my full names. Name after my husband's name, Valentine. I'm a teacher by profession. I did my first degree on education, Bachelor of Arts with education. And then I made a progress on master's level, specifically on the issues of development studies. In our country, development studies is something like a core course, because we have so many things to do with the development studies. And I'm currently working as an assistant lecturer from the Department of Gender Studies and Community Development.
And then say the name of your college again, now that you have a mic.
The college name is the Mwalimu Nyerere Memorial Academy. Yes, this is the college named after our first president, the one who fought for independence of Tanzania, by then Tanganyika. We were first known as Tanganyika. And then we united with the Zanzibar to make the name Tanzania. So we were first known as Tanganyika, and then we unite with the island of Zanzibar and Pemba, and then we came with one name, Tanzania. So the first president of Tanzania was the Mwalimu Nyerere, and our college was named after his name. In our college, yes, we got independence on the 9th December of 1961, and we are almost celebrating 50 years of our independence in Tanzania.
Okay.
Mothers Union is a growing organization heading to almost 115 members, 115,000 members, and who we have a major mission of caring for families, Christian caring for families. Members are involved in caring for those in need, vulnerable children, widows, as well as people living with HIV/AIDS. In our continent, HIV is an issue. We have a number of people who are infected, those who are already sick, and as Mothers Union, we thought it is something we can do to show them the love of Christ. They are confused, frustrated, they have lose hope of life. They lose hope because it's like they totally know that they are going to die. So as Christians, especially the mothers, who most of those who are infected are within our families, we tend to do that service to save them, to give them hope, and to support them in life. We also raise issues and campaigning. We have in Tanzania, we have now almost 28 dioceses, Anglican diocese, and Dar es Salaam is among those 28 dioceses. So there are some dioceses which are highly advanced, and there are those which are typically in rural areas of Tanzania. So we decided to start in microcredit savings groups, as well as focus on health issues, focus on empowerment of women. If I may tell you, we still have a challenge of equal treatment between men and women, girls and boys. There are so many issues of preference to boy child than the girl child. Issues of inheritance are more focused on boys than girls, or even sometimes sending boys to school and leave girls aside, simply because the attitude is that women are to take care of the family. They will be fed by their husbands. So they have to take the role to cook, to wash, to clean, and all that. So education is not that important. So for Mothers Union, we have that need and a call to focus on empowering women, doing some seminars, educating them. Why do we think women should be educated, should be employed? Because the return for their education and employment in the family is very big. We can also reduce poverty if women are also empowered. So at Mothers Union, we started those microcredit savings. People will contribute small amount, and then at the end, they get a bit of amount, establish a small project, which will generate income for themselves and for their families. Just an emphasis that we, as Mothers Union Tanzania, our projects include what we call credit scheme, which support women initiating their own small micro enterprises projects. We also do poultry farming, keeping chicken, and encouraging women to grow crops around homesteads and to do arts and craft. You know, like the dress I wore is a work of one of our Mothers Union member. She made it and sell it to other Mothers Union. But you also have, in Dar es Salaam, we have 53 parishes. And in our diocese, almost, there are almost like 6 parishes where we run the nursery schools, which are under the control of Mothers Union. So we make sure that our children get what is really desired for them to grow mentally and spiritually. The thing I talk about before I move to this, it's common to our country for someone to have children from 6 to 9, 8, 10 children only in one family. So we have a number of children within our parishes and our diocese, you know? Children are big in number. Yeah, so it's a bit different. Yeah, you see everyone, 1 child, 2 children. We have 6, 7. And if you don't have that much, you seem to be not serious to... You're not serious. Like myself, I have only 2 children. Culture, and that culture is now changing because of the life, the reality of life. Life is hard. You need to send your children to school. You need to feed them properly. So you have to make your calculation properly as well. You don't give birth and expect someone to take care of your own children. You need to be responsible. So due to those who have been to school, so due to that, people now are educated, and through the seminars we're giving, we are having now people who are using contraceptives just to make sure, even if they have 3 or 4 children, there's a space between one child and another so that they can get enough time and enough money to care. So that is an advantage, is an achievement for Mothers Union in Tanzania. Seeing that women now are not just proud of having children, but they're also concerned about how to bring them up to be useful to the society. We are currently working on the vision with youth by nurturing their spiritual and social well-being. We pledge to support girls' education by building hostels. Acknowledge economic hardship of men and women in our congregations. The hostel projects will offer them employment and contribute to the economy. We say we support girls' education by building hostels because we have a challenge. There's still a high rate of violence, domestic violence in our country. There's still that cultural attitude of lagging women behind. So if they just go from home to school, they might come across any domestic violence which lead them to get early pregnancy, and they fail to accomplish their mission to get enough education. We also aim to integrate the idea of leaving no one behind by expanding the Agenda 2030. All these sustainable development goals focus on quality education, they focus on gender equality and a well-educated and learned society. All this has to do with what exists within our countries. So it's like to push up, to make sure at least we have a 50-50 number of girls and boys to school. Because you may end up, yes, they establish school, but there are more boys than girls. So we have that idea as Mothers Union to make sure that we incorporate those Millennium Goals as well as Sustainable Development Goals to make our society improve academically. As we said, we are not that developed. We are still developing. So schools are far away. You may find you need to walk almost like 5 miles to get to school. And not every family can afford school transport. or buses, so they need to walk. So long walking distance to and from school is a problem, especially to girls. High risks or by road sexual harassment and rape is what we are worrying about and thinking of having such a project like hostels. And we already have number of girls who are pregnant and who have children because of those effects. So we want to prevent, but also we want to take care of those who are already victims. Girls poor academic performance due to home cause. As I said earlier, our culture, you might have a boy and a girl, and the girl will be assigned all the activities at home simply because she's a girl. So you wash, you clean, you help your mother to cook, you do this, and the boy is just either doing the assignments and playing. So by that, girls' performance goes down. And we just say, you know, girls don't have, they're not smart, but it's not that they're not smart. They are not given chances to prove their smartness. So at Mothers Union, we thought if they get a hostel, it will be a good time for them. They will have more time to study and they can perform. The objectives behind the building of that hostel is to sustain the number of girls enrolled in school, to reduce those chances of sexual harassment to school girls, and to create good environment for girls' academic performance. And we have already seen those who have been in the hostel, even their performance has raised up. And we also have some research which are done to other schools, not necessarily done by Mothers Union, but as a lecturer, we also do research. And also we realize that if girls are given good, conducive environment, they can do wonders. Our expected outcome are connected to our objectives. Reduce the number of girls who dropping out in the nearby schools, reduce the number of sexual harassment cases in the area, and to increase the girls' performance, which is obvious that they will. That we have planned to have four clusters of the hostel, and this is the first cluster. We started to build it with our own energy as Mothers Union. The piece of land was given to us by the diocese, but the construction, it started by our own small contribution. And also friends' contribution. I remember there was one time Salaam and Dick visited us, and they bring a support from you people. And the house was not painted and was not even having tiles, no toilets. And we managed to use that money to paint the hostel, the first cluster we have started, which took almost like 20 students. And we also have tiles as you can see, the floor. The floor was very rough, so through the support, we managed to have a comfortable place for our girls to stay. And the comfortability improved also the academic performance. We are not done with the construction. As we said, there's no electricity in those buildings. And they at night, they want to do preparation for the next day. They cannot do that because there's no electricity and we need money to do that.
How many girls? 20
to
25.
Yes, in one. Oh, yeah, because we have the double decker. Yeah, four rooms each. Yeah, and also we need a fence because the location, most of the houses, we are in summer urban. So, and these are girls, we need to take a good care of them. We need to protect their security to have them secured. So we also thought to have that plan of building a fence. And also raise water, but we need a reserve, because sometimes water went out. So we need something like a reserve for them. When water is not there, they can use the reserve, and they can reduce time to go searching for water and concentrate on their studies. I'm therefore here, first of all, thanking very much Celine for when we share these ideas, when you see our struggles as Mothers Union, she decided to have an idea that you can't do it all alone. These are our children, and we preach love. We preach sacrificing. So we'll try. I know I have good people in Oregon. Please come and share your issues. And I therefore here in front of you calling for fund support from your church, from parishes, from individuals, from your families. Anything will be of great use. There's nothing small. And the whatever you give is like a seed. It will grow and it will multiply. And it will be very delightful to give the feedback of what we are doing and how far has it reached and to what extent has supported and improved our community. By saying so, I just want to put remarks to appreciate on behalf of the Mothers Union in Tanzania, to appreciate again the support and contribution of Mr. and Mrs. Celine Bach for their great support to development initiatives. Vote of thanks to you all for reaching out to the core. You could have something else to do, but you decided to come and say, let's hear this lady from Tanzania. What does she has to say? This is what I am here for. Humbly thanking my fellow women and my church for entrusting me this duty. Thank you for listening. Thank you very much.
Empowering women in your country is a pretty radical idea. How's it being received, particularly by the government and other things?
Thank you. The government is also hand in hand. Only that we have a big population, and they can't do it by themselves. But there are issues which they do, for example, to make sure that we have enough teachers. Because even the ratio of teachers and students, the ratio of teachers is very low. So the government is trying to construct schools, at least to make sure at every ward there is a school, and also to make sure that teachers are available, and the stationaries such as books, and having good curriculums which they can transform from school to work. So that is what the government is doing. And also they have removed the school fees for lower secondary levels, just to make sure that many people, many students, girls and boys, are enrolled in their education. Yeah, so the government is also doing a lot. But only that we have a big number. Yes.
How much is the dinner? It's by donation only.
Oh, okay.
We have a donor for the dinner, so whatever you put in the... We have an African bowl, and whatever you put in that bowl, that's what we send to Grace.
Grace gets all the money for the dinner. We don't tell you how much. We just expect deep pockets.
If we write a check.
To Trinity Church.
Okay.
And put Grace Mokiwa on the bottom. And if you can't come to dinner, just write a check anyway.
Yeah.
You spoke about the issue of the people dying from HIV/AIDS. Is there a medication project? Because there are medications that can help, but is it coming to your country?
Yes.
Is it?
Yeah. Yes, there is. Yeah. But for...
It does well with him.
Yes. For rural areas, it's still a challenge. Yeah. But it is still a challenge. And sometimes they may go and be told, maybe come next week. We are running out of stuff, of the stock. Yeah.
Yes, please.
The hostels, I'm assuming, are they free for the girls to stay there? And I'm assuming there's an adult supervising and everything, but how is that being accepted in the culture where girls are supposed to be at home and taking care of the home? Do you get a lot of applications to go to the hostels, or?
Yes, we do get application. As I said, there is transformation day by day. The yesterday's Tanzania is not the current Tanzania. We keep educating. We keep, the government is keeping on educating the society on the need for the girl education. So not all who can afford, but our price are lower.
Okay.
And also sometimes we have individuals who support those who cannot even give that small amount.
Okay.
Just to make sure that we cover our mission. Yes. Yes.
What are the different classes that the girls are taught, and how do you find teachers to come and teach?
How do we find teachers? We have two categories of schools. We have the public schools, and we have the private schools. Under the public schools, the teachers are being directed where to go, but sometimes they don't go if those areas do not have the supporting social services, which is the major problem in our country. So there are some regions in our country where there are no teachers. One school may have only three or two teachers and a number of 500 students, you can imagine. And our classrooms, most of them, if it is the lower grades from primary, grade 1 to 7, one class may have up to 200 students, one stream, and only one teacher. Because first of all, the teachers are not well paid in our country, so people will not opt to be a teacher because they cannot get enough support from the salary of just being a teacher. Also, the government is working on it to improve the salary so that people can be interested to be teachers. And for the private, most of those with high income, well economically, they will send their children to private schools. So the good salary you offer, the more teachers you get. And most of the private schools are run by English curriculum. And they fly a lot of teachers from Uganda and Kenya because of the good English. English in Tanzania is like a third language. We have vernacular language of our own tribe, Ameru by tribe, and then I have Swahili as a national language, and then English, which I just meet it when I'm in grade 3. We learn English as a subject, not as the language for communication, no. We have Swahili as a language for communication, English as a subject, up to grade 7, just doing English as a subject in public schools. But in private schools, it's different. They start English from the lower grades. And all the medium of instruction in those schools is English. So even the payment salary for teachers is good. So they have many teachers and small number of students on each classroom.
Yes,
please.
So for your country to overcome the major challenges that women face, the scope of the cultural shift extends way beyond education, as I'm sure you know. So what are government leaders doing to send the message to the country and to the culture and the society that basic perceptions of women need to change, beyond just the infrastructure of education? Is that happening?
It is happening, but it's not a one-night change. We don't expect it. Because sometimes when it comes to issues in the family, people will not intervene too much. They will leave some freedom of the family to decide. Only when it denies human rights and people manage to report, because we have now a number of activists who are educating the society and telling women to open up and speak, because sometimes women themselves, they feel shy to say that they are denied that right. And how can you come as a government and intervene? It's very difficult. They have to speak out. And that's what Mothers Union, so we bring different people to educate women. The women who are beaten are still beaten by their husbands. And when you ask, you say, you know, I fall down. They can't disclose it. I fall down, you know. Or they want their daughters to get married early so that they can get bride price. You know, most of the cultures, you marry, you may ask to give up to 50 cows, just like as a bride price. So some parents, because of poverty, are tempted that they can just marry their children while they're still young, at the age of going to school. So unless someone give up the information, that's where the government can intervene. But we still, the government has already put in place some laws which will hold parents responsible for mistreating girls or for denying rights for girls and boys.
Due to time, I'm gonna ask Grace to show the next slideshow. And it shows you the importance of water and why this affects women. And she's got wonderful pictures here. And we can't imagine what this is like. We turn on the faucet. The people in the villages don't. And she'll be real clear about this because this is amazing. Okay.
As the presentation on the background, the water supply situation in Tanzania is very critical. With our more than 50 years of independence, but still people, half of the population does not have access to safe and hygienic water. Water shortages are a chronic problem in Tanzania, mostly affecting the rural population. In my diocese, where I'm coming from, it is in Dar es Salaam, but the diocese covers the coastal part. So we also have rural deaneries where the water is really a problem. According to 2013 report on the country's water sector development program, Tanzanian government still facing challenges to provide enough clean water for its people, especially in rural. But this is a report which says especially in rural, but who we are living in Dar es Salaam, I can tell you the problem of water is even within the urban centers. You get it twice or thrice a week, and you need to go for a queue to get that water, or you need to use money to get a car to bring water in your home, something which cannot be afforded by the majority. Those are the kind of sources of water that you can see a girl struggling to fetch water, a poor water source in Pwani. Pwani is coastal. Like many poor nations around the world, Tanzania suffers from serious issues involving its people in regards to water. Consequently, Tanzanians tend to face water which contains things like bacteria or human waste, especially during rain season. Because of poverty, people cannot hire a car to come to clear the waste. So during rain season, people will open up their toilets and the waste may just go and affect the sources of water. And those sources, they are very poor, they are not protected, so it's easy to be contaminated. People have to choose to drink from bath in or wash their clothes in those areas. And according to Tanzania National website, waterborne illness, such as malaria and cholera, account for over half of the disease affecting the population. You know, when the water, most of the water are just not the running water. So it's easy for mosquitoes to lay eggs and the problem increase, as well as cholera. Why? Because people don't have access to sanitary options. Sometimes they know this water is not safe, but what is the option? They don't have an option. It's better to have them rather than not having it at all. You can see there.
Somebody's going to wash their clothes in that water. Or drink it.
Yeah. And that's also is because of low level of education. The uneducated will not do that. And that's why we fight for education. Education is almost everything. Most of the educated will not do that, even if the water is not clean, but they will not mess up more with that water. How the absence of safe water affects women and girls. Again, the issue of culture, the issue of socialization comes in. Water shortage affects women mostly in education. We have to go to fetch water. Or in the morning, if you fail to get water, maybe that last evening, girls will be told not to go to school. They have to go fetch water because life needs to go on. Infant mortality, poor breastfeeding and malnutrition. Women stays most of the time waiting for water. 2 hours, 3 hours. So that also will affect their other activities at home. Shortage of water endangers women's safety, high risk of sexual assault and rape, women and girls. They get too late, or they have to wake up too early to make sure that they get the water before other people are waking up. Now, as I said, we don't have enough electricity. No lights on the roads, so you may wake up very early, it is dark. Someone can do anything to these women, and they may end up also being infected with HIV.
Do you have any incidents like Okap alarm?
No, not in Tanzania. So far we don't have Boko Haram. Shortage of water also affects women's health. Obviously, a problematic during menstruation and the other body functions. Most of girls do not go to school when they are on that period. Because even the latrines is a challenge to school. they don't have enough, maybe to buy pads, and there is no water most of around our schools, so they may just decide to stay home. Shortage of water increased burden of household activities to girls and women to fight against hunger. You use a lot of time to fetch water. You don't have time to produce. You don't have time to do commercial activities. So automatically, the hunger will face the family. And the statistics tells us that 70% for agriculture activities and 10% for domestic use. As a school girl with bucket of water after school, it's really a headache. You need to come and see, you know, when I explain, it's not easy to, you may think maybe it's over-exaggerated. No, it's even worse than what you see there. Some scenarios you can't get immediate pictures of how life really is on the challenge of water availability.
Kind of hard to see, but her water is on her head.
Yeah, we always carry on our heads 20 liters. And sometimes you support with 5-liter gallons just to make sure you have enough stuff. And you may walk without holding it with your hand, and it's so common for us. I wish I could come with a bucket to demonstrate. I can also do it. I was grown up in the rural areas as well. Only that I was like my parents were educated, and they also sent me to school. Now, how this water availability can help women and girls in Tanzania is like the opposite of the challenges they get. The availability of water will increase girls' school attendance. Level of education and illiteracy rates, and they no longer need to miss school to secure water for their families and have adequate and separate sanitation facilities. This is what your support for water will do to our girls back there. Improved health for women and girls who no longer have to delay defecation and urination. Reduced child and maternal mortality as a result of access to safe water, sanitation facilities, and improved hygiene during childbirth. Increased, sometimes, I forgot this, you have a little baby and they don't have nets or pampers. So we use a piece of cloth to tie on our babies. And when there is a shortage of water, when it is wet, you put it on the sun to dry so that you can repeat again. But this is because there's no water. And this can also result into infections to the child. And that's why so many mortality rates, every now and then. It will reduce that child and maternal mortality as a result of access to safe water. Increase dignity and reduce psychological stress for girls and women, particularly when symptoms associated with menstruation, pregnancy, and childbirth can be managed. Reduced physical injury from constant lifting and carrying heavy loads of water. Sometimes we fall down with those buckets and people get the backache. Mm. Sometimes they break legs, especially during rain season, and you need to go for water very far around maybe mountains to where you can find some holes with the water. So when you are going down or up, someone may fall down. Reduce risk of rape, sexual assault, and increase safety as women and girls do not have to go to remote and dangerous place to eat or to fetch water during the night. Increase recognition of women as having skills and knowledge outside the scope of their traditional roles. strengthen the voice for women in their families and communities to negotiate their own needs. New opportunities for women's employment as well as greater autonomy and independence. We always, whatever we do, we become models. I remember when my husband became a bishop, we have a very low number of women who were educated. But because they see the benefit of me being educated, they see we have two salaries coming in instead of just waiting for the priest to bring something. Most of priest wives went to school, went to get some skills. So whatever you do, people learn something and they move from one step to another. And this makes the community always improve day by day. This is what I have to say. Thank you for listening. Thank you for your time.
We have a few minutes for questions. I know some people had their hands up before.
Carol. What are the men and the boys doing all this time?
That they're not helping out.
As I said, some boys.
Culture?
Yeah, it's a culture. And they might be doing something else, but will not consume as much time as what the activities girls and boys and women are doing. It's not that they do nothing, but what they do can be done in a very short time, and they can have other time to do other things. While the need for water is every day,
there are no wells.
No well. So there is no way you can excuse yourself. And because of that mentality that this is a women activities, it needs to be done by men and by women and girls. And that's where the problem comes. And that's where now there is a need, like what I say, we are teaching gender studies. Gender studies is not about women being equal to men, but also trying to wash away those attitudes, those negative attitudes, which our societies have about the relationship between men and women. Those ideas of subordinating women is what we try to make the society be aware that there's no advantage of making women behind. Rather, there is a much disadvantage of lifting men and women and girls behind.
The guy in blue over
there. Lee and Grace, could you tell us the cost of putting in a well?
Yeah. What's happening is the churches are now putting in the wells. And for $4,500, the Tanzania Water Project can drill a well. It's a group of people from Texas who bought their own rig, only in Texas. But and so they do it for about half the price of anybody else. But they have a very interesting system. The parish has to raise some money, not the whole $4,500, that's a lot for Tanzania. But they raise money, Tanzania Water Project raises money, then they come with everything you need, they drill the well, they bring the generator, they have everything. They teach the people how to use it, and then they make them sign a contract. And that contract says you have to maintain your well. Mm-hmm. So, and then what they say, if it's not being maintained, we'll pull that wellhead and give it to another village. Therefore, maintenance is now very important, and they haven't pulled any yet. Because a lot of people in Tanzania don't know how to fix this kind of technology, but these guys learn how to do it. The parishes then, if somebody is rich, they ask for a little money so they can maintain it. If somebody is poor, they get the water for free. So for $4,500, you have water for the whole village, right there in the middle of the village.
Yeah.
And they don't have any rules about who can use it. You can be Christian, you can be Muslim, everybody can come. We went to one, it was the Water Project. There was not a Christian church there.
Yeah.
Everybody was Muslim, so, you know, we had a little ceremony with the priest, we did all that, They're going to plant a church there because the Christians brought water. That's evangelism.
Yeah. You said it well, Celine. There was a hand for the lady there.
Okay.
Yes, please.
Yes. Are vaccinations available for preventing diseases of sorts, especially for children?
Yes.
So we can vaccinate the kids. Do all children get vaccinated?
Yeah, there are some diseases which during clinic period, they get the vaccination. Yeah. And you know what, when I was, for example, when I was coming, I was planning my travel to here, I have to get a yellow fever vaccination, and you have to pay 50,000 Tanzanian shillings to get such a vaccination.
That's $25.
Yes. Now, you can imagine how many can afford. You know? Sometimes there are some bureaucratic kind of to get those services. But the government has the plan and the free, it's constitutional that the vaccination should be free for the children under the 5 years of age.
Wait, somebody in the back.
I just wanted to ask, we were talking about the wells of the whole village. So how many families are we talking about that would supply water for?
It may be up to 20 to 30 families. Yeah. And with one family having 10, 6 members, 12 members. Because you also believe on extended family. I stay with my uncles, my cousins, you know. Not just me and my husband and children. We also have other family members with us. Most of the families are like that.
You were talking about a reservoir?
Yes.
And where would that be in conjunction with the hospital?
We have a tanks. We buy tanks.
Okay.
They are tanks. And then we put water as a reserve. Because even for those areas where there are tap waters, they don't be running every day. Because they need to be like divided 2 days in this side, maybe 3 days on the other side. Because even the availability is not meeting the number of population we have.
I just wondered if the water table is such that wells could be drawn or could be available in most rural areas.
In some areas.
Some areas.
In some areas. Okay. And in other areas also there's a very salty water. Mm-hmm. Can just be used for maybe washing, cleaning. Sometimes they cannot be used for cooking or drinking. So it's also a problem on the water table. Some can access, you can get some which is good for use. And sometimes there's dry land where you cannot even drill water. Yeah.
Where Grace lives, they can't drill a well.
Yeah.
It's too deep. They try. There's no water on their property.
Yeah.
They bring it. They bring their water by truck.
Yeah.
Anything else? Yes.
Just real quick, Grace. In the States, social media sites are a primary means of awareness. You know, it's a way for us to know and to have like a fundraising mechanism. I mean, does Mothers Union have any presence on like Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, Twitter, so that Americans can be more aware of this need?
We have it for the Tanzania as general, but for the diocese, we are just on the process of establishing a website so that we can place everything and people can know what's going on. But again, we have electricity problem challenge. Sometimes we don't have even those computers. Some cannot use them. You can have them, but people have no knowledge of computer, though we are now having those who are doing that for employment, because it's easy. If you have a knowledge about computer, you can open a stationery, you can print, you know. We don't print our own. I have a work, I don't have a PC, I need to send it to someone to type for me. It's very common, but it's a good idea, I think. I will take it to improve. Thank you.
Given the conditions in the villages, how do you protect the generator that pumps the water out of the well? And where do you get the fuel?
Well, first you hire a security guard.
Yeah.
More employment.
Yes, we hire a security guard. Mm-hmm. Of course, we usually tend to take the local ones. You can just pay a big little. And those who are maybe their houses are around the where the generator is, so that they can just be around and they cannot stop doing other activities. And then we also sometimes get people who can donate for putting some metals around it, and we close it with the lock. Yes, Dick?
Grace, we also noticed the very large storage tanks.
Yes.
So what they might do is use a generator and fill up that tank.
Yes.
And then take it away.
Yes.
Secure it and then bring it back when they need to use
we
it.
We need, yeah, we always do that. And the fuel, sometimes the church itself can donate fuel. The Mothers Union, sometimes we sell things, we donate, especially when the area maybe they have people with disability, people who cannot work for themselves. People will much like to donate on such kind of situation.
I will tell you that the Mothers Union is so strong in Tanzania. It's another example of women doing the work. They raise money. I mean, they've raised a lot of money to build this. The Tanzanian method is you only build when you have cash in hand. No bank loans. So this project's been going for 10 years, and we're just about ready to put the first girls in there.
And the same applies to other churches. They're also doing the same, the Catholic Church, the Lutheran Church. They're also doing the same. But there is a challenge. Most of the churches in the coastal have been affected also with the culture. And also, so most of the people are not educated. It's different from other setting of the churches like Lutheran and the Catholic, where they were educated, they send their children to school, and therefore they have a number of people who are employed with good employment. And therefore, even the contribution within the church is high. And in the coastal where we are serving, there are a number of Muslims. And during missionaries' mission in Tanzania, they didn't want to send their children to school because these were Christian and they were Muslims. So the development is lagging behind.
Okay, it's time for church. Grace will be here during coffee, and she'll answer any questions, and she'll always be around all week. So if you have questions, just let us know.
Thank you.